6 Cheviot Place in Greenpoint, the home of the late Erik Laubscher and Claude Bouscharain. Today, I'm going to show you a little bit more about the history of this interesting home.
So, Henk, tell us more about the interesting people who lived in this home.
Number 6 Cheviot Place has got a very specific and very important history in South Africa and also in the art world. It is the home of the late Erik Laubscher, very famous South African painter, and his French wife, Claude Bouscharain. They purchased the property after they returned from Paris, where they both did residencies, where they met very influential artists like Ferdinand Léger, a very famous Parisian cubist painter. And on their return to South Africa, the influences that they picked up in Europe became apparent in their own work. They also shared the home with two other very important South African figures called Jan Rabie, an Afrikaans writer, and also Marjorie Wallace. She was from Scottish descent, also a visual artist. Cheviot Place at the time, I think it was 1956, you have to contextualize it within the time. You have to remember that in 1956, I think the Nationalist Party already instituted apartheid, which was kind of legalized for 7 years. And these artists and painters and philosophers challenged the societal rules by the Nationalist government through their writings and also through their art.
Come here.
What's that one?
This is what you see from here.
Yes.
With the church and the stadium.
Well, I think when I left the property, I became so aware of the fact that homes are actually narratives. They sort of represent certain stories, and I think some of these stories are still apparent in this home. We are currently sitting in the studio of Erik Laubscher, and in the window there are these bottles with beautiful pigments of French ultramarine and beautiful reds, and they reference actually his paintings. He was very well known for interpreting the South African landscape, and specifically the Swartberg landscape and the Overberg landscape. And what he did in these landscapes was that he kind of incorporated these cubist ideas of simplifying these landscapes into planes of color and geometry. And in this specific space, you can also see, I suspect that palette, for instance, is a palette of Claude Bouscharain, his wife, and her last studio was in the front of the home with a beautiful view of the Atlantic Ocean and also Robben Island in the distance. It's actually very interesting when you stand on the stoop. It's almost as if a Robben Island is framed exactly in the middle of your view. And I think also, if you contextualize this Robben Island having such an important place in South African history with Nelson Mandela, which spent about 27 years of his life there. And then I, on my way here, I thought about Ingrid Jonker, the Afrikaans poet who wrote this poem with the name of Die Kind, which was read by Nelson Mandela at the opening of Parliament, the only Afrikaans piece of literature ever to have been read in Parliament. And it also indicates the very interesting kind of things that happened in this home. It was a melting pot for artists, writers, philosophers, and some of these people became very important figures in South African history, like Athol Fugard was here, Ingrid Jonker, André Pierre Brink, and then also colored writers such as Adam Small and Peter Bloom. And you have to remember, in 1956, this was actually prohibited by government. So this house became a melting pot for people from different cultures, religions, Even later political figures like Albie Sachs actually visited this home at some point. This home hasn't been changed in 70 years, so it is almost as if you walk into a encyclopedia or a library of a lifetime spent in this home. Erik and Claude's daughter, Francesca, wrote a beautiful essay in the book on Erik Laubscher, in which she kind of referenced what it felt like growing up in the home. And she would kind of mention how she would walk up the balustrade and she would smell the burnt toast of Marjorie Wallace. And when you walk up the balustrade, at the beginning of the balustrade, there's this almost like naive sculpture, which most probably was carved by Erik himself. If you enter the kitchen, the cupboards are quite peculiar, almost in this kind of 70s style, but they were actually made by Erik himself. And then when you walk out of the kitchen door, you walk into this kind of very overgrown informal garden with these rosemary bushes. And if you, for instance, go into a book like The Artist's Palette, you will see that Erik Laubscher actually, in this book, made a rack of lamb, so one can actually envisage him walking into the garden, taking a sprig of rosemary, throw it into the pot. So it's kind of as if art and life, in a way, just came together in this home.
Henk, tell me again, what's the story about the fig tree?
Well, trees play a very significant role in this dwelling. Francisca, who is the daughter of Erik and Claude, mentions it in an essay. She mentions this beautiful oleander tree and this wonderful wild jasmine at the entrance of the home. And when you enter the home, there's this beautiful stained glass window that almost looks like a smiley face. And then there's the fig tree. If you stand on a stoop, you can see it on the left, and she's got these wonderful memories of ripe figs from this tree. And she also describes how she walked up the beautiful balustrade in the middle of the house, and when she got upstairs, it felt as if she was in a tree house, which in itself is a wonderful and a beautiful story. I also think the light in this house is very interesting for me. When Marjorie, who all through her life, Marjorie Wallace, the famous painter, did lots of paintings of most probably the interior of this house, and also little still lives with this beautiful soft yellow light in it. And I can understand where that inspiration comes from. The full Edwardian home is filled with wonderful poetic yellow light. Also interesting in this specific room is this window, which is southern facing. And when you study art, often they tell you when you move into a studio, you have to have southern lighting if you're a painter.
Interesting.
Yeah, so it's just like really interesting that the whole home was almost like designed and arranged around artistic practice. And then we should also remember that this was also the home of Claude Bouscharain, his very elegant French wife, who spent some time in Switzerland. And her work was a wonderful kind of blend between surrealist and hard-edge painting ideas. Her work has got a very almost like understated coolness, cool palette, often incorporating human figures in these kind of surreal environments. Also a very celebrated artist who is currently doing extremely well in the secondary market on auction as well.
Okay. I mean, I could look at it as brick and mortar, as a house to sell, and you came into this space and gave it a complete different angle for me.
I think they are very well-known public figures, but by entering the home, you almost make a incision of the personal into history and the incision of the personal into the public realm. And you don't only now know them through their work and their wonderful contribution to cultural life, but also maybe just see the spaces that they inhabited, the music that they collected, the books that they read, and most probably informed their ideas as human beings. Yeah, it creates an emotional resonance yeah. to the home, something that we tend to forget. Homes are places that people live in.